next vote by CNN. Observational status of agents.
First of all, I thank both the teacher and women for sending me to give this talk. Because of this talk, I went back to some of the things I used to do in the past. It's really trying to understand quasar outflows. As the title suggests, I'm going to use only absorption. That means most of the time you are not going to see any images. We will look at spectra of different sources, and try to understand various physical processes and physical configurations, which will be basically what we see in one dimension. So I don't have to go into this in great detail because we already have two talks where there is enough motivation for us to see why we study agent outflows. We want to understand this kinematic, dynamic nature. See, this is first point is to say that whenever you find any object, you can study it on its own. You don't have to worry about what winds will do, rather we can try to understand what winds are. In that case, what we want is that you want to know location, geometry, and you want to see that what is the curving factor of the wind. And once you start with any physical picture, you will start asking what is the stability, how long this wind configuration will remain stable. If it is stable for a long period of time, what is the content? Of course, we heard a bit about what can drive the flow, whether it is MLT or radiation hydrodynamics or pure hydrodynamics. These are the questions one would like to address, understand, and ask. The second thing is that we now realize that quasar central engine could be a special place where star formation could have happened at a much rapid pace. In that case, like whether is there any connection between star formation and the outflows? And you would like to know, like, second thing we would also like to address is that is there any connection between backward and starburst? Other way of saying is that what is the coupling, which we started discussing in last lectures? We have so much power, maybe this power doesn't last for long. And what is the coupling? And if there is a coupling, how you are going to distribute over the full galaxies? Of course, there is a broader picture. So one would like to see like where the agents are actually formed. Are they formed in a region which is sort of dusty environment where black hole is sort of assembling itself, and when you see quasar as a shining light, are we seeing a transition of this into an AGN or something? Of course, we also would like to understand how these outflows can influence the heating and metal enrichment of IGM, ICM, black hole bulge relations. And in fact, understanding theoretical modeling of luminosity function of galaxies, which basically fail to produce the correct shape if you don't take into account these kind of feedbacks. Of course, this is usual way of introducing a topic when you are doing observational astronomy. We say a lot of motivations are there. But what one is going to do is very simple, right? What our plan is to have a background source which is going to sit in the central regions. We are going to look at electromagnetic radiation, either it is optical, X-ray or radio, which comes out of this central region, and try to see whether this radiation can pick up signatures of materials which are lying between us and these objects. In particular, in the region of circumnuclear nucleus of these objects. So we already heard about optical and UV energy. You have broad absorption line, narrow associated absorption lines, they actually probe these regions. In fact, one can see that in addition to this absorption line, one can start using these diffuse emission lines. You see some examples this morning. I'll go further, a little more into it. To see like, what kind of flows which are contributing to this central gas in the central region. So even though I preferentially I look for outflows, I'm not going to be blind to the info. Or a confined gas which is going around the central supermassive black hole itself. So the idea here is, even though this talk is titled as outflows, you will find that at different times, we may also worry about other flows which may be relevant for the study of overall feedbacks. So actually, we heard about warm ionized gas and also ultra-strong outflows. Then we will touch upon these two things. One is the UV regime, second thing is the radio regime. In radio regime, basically, we are going to concentrate on 21 cm absorption lines from the central regions of these agents. So these two slides is just my interest, and this is what I have been doing. So I'll just go through these things in a simple way and give emphasis to some of the puzzling things one sees in recent times, and let's try to ask how that can be built into the general picture one is talking about. Of course, properties of all quasars. Board of Doppler quasars are very famous for very large workflows. Velocities are large, widths are large. I took an extreme example. Here is a Langmuir emission which is not very prominent in this quasar, and that nitrogen phi emission should be somewhere here, and one detects nitrogen phi doublet in absorption. Very large velocity, which is of the order of 0.1 c roughly, right? Sort of if you look at this, it's a very interesting case. I said like one can have large velocities, widths are also large, still you are preserving the ionization state of the gas. I mean, this is one point I wanted to just bring out. Second thing is that one has to understand what is the nature of the velocity profile itself. Of course, it's very easy to model the profile once you know what you are seeing, right? You can say smooth wind, or you can say that the wind in which clumps are embedded. This is important for us to know what you actually see. In fact, in bulk quasars, most of the time what you see depends on what kind of data you have. Right? If you have a relatively low resolution spectra, most of the time you see that things are some sort of smooth, large velocity scales. Whereas if you observe the same thing with higher resolution, this is basically observed in Keck, and you begin to see that there are, in addition to broader components which one sees, this is carbon 4 absorption. You can also see several narrow components which are embedded in them. So it is very important for us to realize that this is much more complex, right? This is the thing one has to. So when you are modeling, we have to keep in mind that you are modeling the data in hand. If you have a much better data, your modeling may be slightly different. Of course, one of the things which came up is what is known as partial coverage. It's clear that even though you see absorption line along the line of sight, most of the time these absorption lines don't go to zero. These are not dark absorption like what you see in stellar wind. This is one big difference one sees between OB-star winds and quasar outflows. It's my understanding of this thing is that quasar outflow is slightly more complex because this background radiating source has emission coming from all scales unlike stars. The case of stars, you know that radiation coming from stars, wind is in the surrounding region, so you know that situation is very well. Whereas in quasar, what happened, a given wavelength, radiation can come from quasar itself, which is something like a few AU scales, because accretion disk you are talking about. It can also have, light photon comes from the broad emission line, which can be of the order of parsec scales, and you can also have a narrow emission line, which can go up to hundreds of parsec scales. For example, if you situate in the center of an emission line, photons can come from all scales. So depending upon which scale this absorption is produced, the photons coming from the larger scales will just come to you without actually passing through this cloud itself. This is an effect one has to take into account. If you want to calculate what is mass outflow rate, you have to be actually sure that you know exactly what you are doing, right? Because it's just not good enough to just integrate the optical depth and say, this is what it is. Because what you are seeing need not be true optical depth. So it is a very interesting demonstration here. So this is the continuum of a quasar fitted, and this is the bottom of absorption line. And okay, this is one of the cutest demonstrations of partial coverage. And you see, you take this line and just put it here, and you can simply see that the bottom of absorption profile simply follows the broad emission line profile. One of the naive interpretations, we'll always do naive interpretations here, is that like this cloud is not covering most of the broad emission line. So broad emission lines are just coming towards you, whereas it covers the central quasar. So you will be able to see the contribution of broad emission line as a profile in the bottom of the absorption line. Okay? So if you don't take care of this, you will think that it is optically thin line, and you calculate the column density, which will be some very nice number. Whereas if you take it upon this, the column density will be a real lower limit, because actually the line is completely saturated. This one has to take it upon. Of course, last talk we heard about radiation-driven wind. One of the clear demonstrations of radiation, a line-driven wind, being very important is what is known as line locking. Line locking is a process in which you see that you will know that carbon 4 is a doublet, and usually two clouds are producing carbon 4 doublets, you will have four absorption lines which are present. There are two clouds. In this particular configuration, what happens is that the cloud velocities are aligned in such a way, velocity difference between two clouds are equivalent to the velocity separation between the doublets. So if there are two lines which are present, you actually see three absorption lines instead of four absorption lines. It's very interesting because one of the first line of absorption from one cloud will coincide with the second absorption time from the other product. This is very nice coincidence. To achieve this coincidence is very, very easy to achieve this coincidence. Imagine net acceleration of one cloud is A, net acceleration of second cloud is B. A minus B should be such that this is the difference between the net acceleration with respect to gravitational deceleration. So what happens when this line is removed? You don't have absorption from this line, so extra acceleration is no more seen. So this cloud is now coasting with constant velocity. It's very nice configuration, but it requires extreme fine tuning. There are two cases. This is a beautiful case where you see this kind of carbon 4 being repeated. In fact, it's a continuum normalized. You see that even partial coverage is beautifully demonstrated in this case. These clouds which are rocked also have a nice partial coverage. Of course, these are all always good because observers always show their best cases. In fact, this is, to my mind, this is one of those best cases one sees in band locking. So what we know now is that basically radiation is playing an important role. Maybe I should take the spirit of today's talk. Radiation may or may not be playing an important role, but you will make an assumption that radiation is very important. Well, at least you see, in one object, I can say that it may be important. So these equations we have seen in different form. So mass outflow rate can be calculated like this. Okay, one of the quantity which has been coming up again and again is to know what is the distance of this absorbing cloud with respect to the source, or where exactly it is located. We would like to know what is the covering factor of the cloud, okay, and what is the density. So these are the questions. If you don't know the density, you can convert them into column density, but you will end up with what is the location of the clouds. So in principle, you can calculate, you can calculate under the assumption of thin shell or outflows of thin shell, you can calculate mass outflow rate, provided you know few quantities, and most crucial quantity is the distance. Distance of the source, because other quantities can be, column density can be directly measured, but what column density you are measuring is ion column density. What is relevant for is the total column density, so that is where the mass is, right? So we have to make some assumptions regarding the corrections, ionization corrections. So column density itself is not measured, by the way. That is an important point to remember. The radius you will measure, provided you understand the ionization mechanism. If you know what is the ratio of ionizing radiation to the particle density, it depends, given luminosity, it depends on distance, you can calculate. So density calculation depends on how you do. If you are brave, you will calculate density through some approximations. If you are lucky, you will find fine structure lines, and you can use level population to derive some constraints on density. I will never say measurements, because these are all constraints, because any level population depends on what you put in, what is the excitation mechanism you are going to put in. The claim is, we have sufficient energy, or E dot, to provide necessary agent feedback for galaxy formation. I think I don't have to go into this, we have enough discussions now. What is sufficient, what is total, we know. Okay. Given this, what I am going to do now is that I will go through what we understand today from observational side, from all quasars. So this will be driven mostly by SDSS, because broad absorption and quasar studies are there forever, right? Ever since first quasars were observed, we start seeing these broad quasars. Actually, these things are very heterogeneous. So to make some progress in the modeling, it is important that we have huge number of sources which are available. And not only number, and also you have some sort of repeated observations which can give some clue. So I will go through it. I am not sure whether you are going to get any clue. At least you will try to build some consensus from the observational side, what theoreticians should aim to look at, or aim to reproduce. So now we know several thousands of bar quasars thanks to SDSS, because it just observes quasars and you see bar everywhere. So typically 15% of optically selected quasars, like in SDSS, show ball signatures. One of the interesting things which was found in the beginning and which is now remain confirmed is that they seem to be X-ray beam. Unlike normal quasars, bar quasars don't show so much X-ray. Even if they show X-rays, the alpha OX is much, much below what one would expect from a standard quasar, which means all quasars are X-ray weak. We don't understand why they are weak, but there are some theoretical models to suggest it. Apart from this, the presence of wall and weakness of X-rays, if you look at optical spectrum, for example, if I show you C3 lines and other lines where there is no absorption, you cannot distinguish the ball quasar from a normal quasar, because only when you see the fact that there is absorption, you can see. If, in fact, what velocity field you will conclude about this outflow depends on which ion you are going to use. For example, if you use carbon 4 line, look at the velocity profile, and you can come up with a model If you look at oxygen 6, your model will be slightly different. If you look at silicon 4, it will be different. What it means is that this flow is actually sort of multi-phase flow, or the density, you have to worry about the ion fractions varying across the velocity field. Of course, it is believed, at least theoretically, one believes that absence of X-ray could be related to something known as shielding gas, which is needed because if you allow the quasars, if you allow the wind to be very close to the quasar and allow all the high energy radiation to pump energy into this, you will find that you will not be able to keep the ions which you are detecting. So one of the ways is to somehow suppress these high energy photons from actually hitting these clouds. They say that there is a shielding gas, and at least one example, there is an example where one sees that this very consistent picture. You have not put it in there. Okay. So this also helps because you are not completely ionizing the gas. You are allowing ions to be present. That means they can absorb photons in lines. So it can, in principle, if you want to set up a radiative driven wind, it is good to keep this after this cloud at a reasonable ionization state, not exactly in a high ionization state. So these are general properties which has never changed because of SDSS. There are certain things which become nice after SDSS has come. This is what I'm going to highlight. One of the things is that in some parts of the sky, SDSS went back to quasars again and again because there were some reverberation mapping studies. There were also other studies. So about few thousand quasars have been reobserved by SDSS again and again. And in fact, about 800 quasars with ball outflows happened to be observed 2-3 times with SDSS. Which means the first thing you can know is that you can go back and ask the question, how stable is absorption ions are? This is one of the things you want to know. So you can go back and find the difference in velocity equivalent wind. Basically what you are doing is that you have two type of observations. You find the change in equivalent wind divided by the average equivalent wind. It is a measure of the variability. You can think of how variable these absorption lines are. It could be related to varying outflow rates, or it could be related to varying ionization state. You have to understand what is causing it. Clearly, this is a time scale. This is the time scale between two epoch observations. This is the change in plotting thing gives you the change in the number of the change in the equivalent wind. And what one sees, this is basically median. You bin them into something and say the sigma, what you find in each bin. And you can see that the large variations typically occur at scales of 2 years, right? Basically, it's around 2 years time scale. Whenever you see this, you are a bit scared because there are more points here compared to the points here. As it turned out that SDSS time scale variations are mainly dominated by which redshift you are observing, because typically there people have gone back in 3-4 years time. So what happens is that, like, if you observe them at low redshift, these time scales are larger compared to observing a high redshift quasar. That gives you these scales which are involved. But what one has to keep in mind is that 50, the first result is that almost all ball quasars show some variability. So 50 to 60% of the balls show variability. And variability is not correlated with quasar properties. It's very interesting. Like, it's variable quasars. Like, for example, it is not that the absorption and variability is related to the variability of continuum light. It's not that the strongly varying quasars show strongly varying absorption light. No. It's not been seen. Of course, even if you look at absorption line, big absorption line, it is not that all absorption lines vary in unison. Within the profile, some part may vary in one direction, some may vary in another direction. This has been also seen. Of course, if you see large amplitude variations, I'll mention what it means. Basically, some absorption completely disappears, or some absorption completely appears. They tend to happen over large time scale. It doesn't happen over a year's month scale or something like that. Typically they happen over 1 to 2 to 3 year time scales. Okay, I'll give an example and maybe 2 years. In fact, looking at this, we started seeing that if you really want to prove that this is the case, we should be probing objects at shorter time scales, right? In the sense that we should periodically observe these quasars so that we can prove that there are quasars where small scale variations are not there, but large scale variations are going to be there. Large scale means time scale variations. This is one of our attempts, so we keep monitoring sources with the Southern African Large Telescope. And you can see that by and large, most of the sources confirm to this, because now we see we populate much more here, because every month we observe, or every year we observe 2 to 3 times. It's clear that if you concentrate on most of these points, it's clear that this trend is okay, but there are also abnormal quasars which show large variations over a period of 3 months. So absorption line can vary over
Are these variations consistent across the different ionization state lines?
Ideally, we would like to see them, but most of the time what happens is that these absorption lines, carbon 4 based things, or magnesium based, vary in a line which is not completely saturated, which means that these cases, most of the time, they are
slower than that.
Yeah. So I will show you some examples where it has been seen that all the lines are varying, but I cannot say 100%
okay.
All of them are.
Does the discriminate university? Is this discriminated by the university?
Discriminated by the
university shift.
Velocity. I have done this here. Basically, these plots, you can look at maximum velocities. So we can look at what kind of correlations one can think of. So this is the plot I am interested in. This is the equivalent width, and these are the measurements at different epochs. The scatter is more when the equivalent width is less. The lines which show strong variations are the lines which are weaker. The second question you want to ask is that if I look at the maximum ejection velocity, look at lines which are traveling at high speeds, are they showing more variations compared to the lines which are moving at shorter time scales? And there is a hint in our data, but in NGSS it is clearly present that most of the highly variable variable absorption are related also to the very large velocities. If you take this velocity to some sort of escape, then you know that these clouds may be much more closer to the black hole, right? And because just want to get this higher potential, so sort of lower separations. So these two things I will not spend time on. You can come back to this. Of course, the most interesting variability is what we call as the transient absorption. And these are two epoch observations are shown here. One is in red and another is dotted, dotted red and black curves. And you can clearly see there are cases where a quasar reaches a wall quasar suddenly become a normal quasar, right? It sort of it just goes away, and this is sort of a disappearance of broad absorption line. There are also cases where some broad absorption lines reappear. This is what we call it as transient wall quasars. It roughly 1 out of 1,000 wall quasars tend to show this kind of transient behavior. Maybe it's like 1 out of 10 wall quasars, I should say. Again, you can ask this question. Basically, you cannot see what I am plotting here. This is the redshift. So we look at the sample of NGSS and ask like, where is the transient wall occurring, right? Whether it's a function of redshift. It seems that sweet spot is around redshift 2. Again, we have to see like we should populate these regions. We are trying to do this now to get more data here. Second thing we can ask is that this is what Yuri was asking. Now you can look at this is the velocity. This is the ejection velocity, and you see the variability. So any variability above this basically means this absorption disappears or appears, because it's a change in equivalent width by equivalent width is of the order of unity. So clearly all these high disappearing clouds occur at ejection velocities much above 10,000 km per second. So clearly this is somehow related to the wind velocity itself. Same thing comes back, all these absorption lines are narrower or low equivalent width lines. So you are thinking of some absorption clump at high speed. Shallow absorption could be related to covering factor. We don't know, but this is the situation one gets. Okay. The same thing is plotted in different ways. So I will move on from here. So here we see some other examples at short time scales. I think one of the questions you asked whether you can see variable absorption in all lines. I mean, this is one of the very special cases. If you look at this black curve, black spectrum. You see several of these narrow absorption lines, which you can see, which is marked with arrows. And actually, this is a carbon 4 absorption, which is completely saturated, that is super saturated, because of which all the low ion lines begin to appear in this state. And you can see them, this is all being marked here. In later epoch, basically, this absorption has dramatically changed. Now it is no more saturated, you can start seeing the velocity profile. In this case, now you see this, all these low ions have disappeared. And this is only case in our sample, where we can see that there is an ionization change associated with the change in the equivalent width of the system. Unfortunately, when we do this, we realize we can go back and look at light curves of these CRTS kind of all-sky monitoring programs. What we find is that this quasar has not varied that much in luminosity. This continuum luminosity has not varied in optical band, but we see clear signatures of ionization variations. So these kind of cases are very interesting, because this could either prove that there is a large variation in the UV continuum, which you don't see without much variation in the optical protein. One of the way we think it can be done is to have the shielding gas sort of going out. In the coverage of shielding gas, if you vary, you will be able to do this. This is demonstrated in the case of NGC 4151 by Nahum Arav, low redshift case, where you can see X-rays. Now, the test is to go back and observe this source in X-rays. If this scenario is correct, this shielding gas is moving around and changing the UV continuum, you should start seeing them varying in X-rays. That is one of the proposals to do that to the person. So, I will just go to an extreme case. I showed you here one of the cases where we have these large variations. I look into this in a bit more detail because this is based on, so start from here. This is the first LGSS epoch observation, and you see an absorption here. This is in magnesium 2. Later on, there is another absorption which formed in 2 years' time in LGSS. Subsequently, we monitor with a 2-meter telescope in India, and you can see that here it is. Just this evolution, it was deeper, and suddenly, once again, disappeared. These four colors are four velocity components we identified. Basically, what happened was, what we call as red component, blue component was created at some state and disappeared. Then we keep monitoring with salt. Again, it started coming up and it disappeared. Actually, last week the spectrum was taken. Now we don't find any ball absorption. And it is a very interesting case. It seems that the growth, decay and growth, seems to follow a cyclic pattern. Exactly we can predict kind of at present. If this is true, it is very interesting. If at all one is thinking of any cyclic process which can go there, can be linked to something which is anchored to an accretion disk which is rotating. We are a bit more ambitious because it's magnesium. It will be a challenging thing to have something very close to the central engine and doing this. In fact, it is interesting. This is the continuum light curve during the same period, and you can see the magnitude difference, peak to peak difference is of the order of 0.2 magnitudes. So basically, you don't have much variations again in optical light. If you look at optical light, you cannot pick this guy as one of the things which will be doing these variations. Again, one can do this something equivalent of whatever people do in the variability analysis to look at some sort of what time scales over which these variations are reported. So you can take any of these clumps, we can calculate RMS deviation at different time scales, and you find a beautiful step function like this. And clearly the characteristic time scale over which this large variation occur turns out to be something like 150 days less periods. Again, we are into few years time scales is what one is talking about, and one has to worry about what is this few year time scale. So one of the conjecture could be this is some sort of a revolving wind, and this is a sort of rotation period. I don't believe this because we can't, each observation we can't give a model, right? We are trying to figure out like whether that period can be related to the period of the shielding gas which is moving around. So it's still, problem is we have already observed this source for nearly 15 years or so, we have to observe more.
Question, so a few months time scale is the natural time scale for a radiative radiotailing stability. So if you accelerate some sheet of gas clump or whatever in such an AGN field, you expect that the column density resolves and that you just basically dissolve the cloud into clumps, and the thicker stuff then accelerates less of those back, and you dissolve the cloud in clumps and reduce the coverage factor. So could it be related to something like that?
But it's 3 years time scale indeed, right? 150 days
is months, isn't it? It's half a year, isn't it?
1500.
Oh, 1500, okay. So it might be a bit longer.
And I think one more thing of interest to you is that I said that it is absorption appearing and is disappearing.
Yes.
So if it happens, why it happens at the same velocity? We find that this ejection velocity is close to 20,000 km per second with respect to quasar, but these variations occur at the same place. So I think there are various ways of phenomenologically one can think of. This may be like there is a flow which is continuously flowing, and your ion side hits when the flow is between velocity V and V plus dV. Right? If you have an accelerated flow, and it's like material going and your side line hits. So all the processes which you are talking need not be present because it may be a smooth flow. For some reason, this alignment is such that you are hitting ion side when start from zero velocity, accelerate and go somewhere, and you keep these guys in the channel.
So how do you say it? Smooth flow? So this disappearing stuff, doesn't it more suggest that isolated things come into the way?
But why it come at the same velocity? Yes, that's the point I'm trying to make.
Yeah.
Some gas which is present is moving out of your sight line. Now new gas is coming. Why should it come at the same velocity? If you are looking through the barrel, you will see them accelerating from some velocity. So either the ionization state occur at a particular distance, so that you start seeing magnesium too, or there is a field line or something which directs this fluid to move in a direction, and you cut that at a particular velocity, which will give you this. That's the, I must say that one object you are thinking, but it's too much. If you have several objects doing this, then you can build a nice story. The second problem I'm facing is that we don't detect any other line. Even after so many, you see each observation, we have 5-6 spectra. So we can go ahead and look at, is there Fe2 line or Fe3 fine structure line? We don't see any of them. So that puts a nice ballpark on what should be the ionization state and what should be the density. But it doesn't allow us to build some physical model. Okay. Let me move on. So now we can ask a broader picture. There are about 80 to 100 disappearing and emerging balls are known in SDSS over a time scale of whatever, 3 years time scale. Now you can ask where they are compared to normal quasars. This is a period in time where observations are taken place, and this is kind of a number of pairs in which you can measure these. This is distribution for typical ball quasar, which need not have shown any emergence or disappearance. But emerging and disappearing seems to be here. This is the point I'm trying to mention. This is basically characteristic timescales of this in 3 years. So we have some ancillary explanation which you have to write when you write a paper, but this has not been supported by any physical model. Second question you can ask, this is the same thing, right? This is the number of spectra. Okay. This we forget, and this is what is more important for us. This is Bonicity index, which is basically a proxy for equivalent width if you want to think in physical terms. And you can see that where this is the distribution of normal ball quasars, where the distribution for disappearing and emerging balls, and you see that this is a picture you have to remember. Things are changing, they are changing when they have large velocities, when the absorption is shallow, and you have to monitor them over 3 years. You have the restraint, that means 10 years time scale. You can plan now, go every 2 years to see, that will be good enough, we will be improving at least 5 time steps within this. Okay, so these are the transient balls. Since I'm running out of time, I'll just see, this is what I have already told. Before going into 21 centimeter, I'm going to give a very interesting object which one found in the case of while dealing with the SDSS, and it will give a lot of interesting clues into infall and outgoing quasars. Okay, this is another. Okay, I have one more thing to say. Next question you want to ask is that all physical models, you say momentum conserving, energy conserving, all models at some stage before the gas reaches terminal velocity predicts acceleration. If this gas is moving in a medium without being shocked or with shock, do you have a drag which produces deceleration? So one has to see whether the absorption line remains there, move in wavelength space. So there are a few examples of acceleration or deceleration, and is even less. It is 10 times less frequent compared to even emerging a disappearing ball quasar. It's an example. You see this carbon 4 profile observed at different time scales. One can actually calculate what is the acceleration as a function of time. So you can put some conditions. You just do the cross correlation and measure what is the acceleration. This is one of the peaks we discovered recently. And this has the maximum acceleration one measures in ball quasars between different epochs. What does one find here? Typically, the acceleration is very small. This is a sample where you can either measure acceleration or make constraints. Change in velocities are very rare. It's the most interesting thing, right? Absorption line goes up and down, or they disappear just like that, right? So, while disappearing, also absorption goes down without changing velocity and disappears. Flow, maybe this tells you that this basically you are in a steady state, right? The flow has changed something. There is no net acceleration in the flow. Or it is not interacting with the ambient. Neither acceleration nor deceleration means it's a free. Okay, now you look at one case where you find acceleration. Now you see that, okay, let me measure acceleration as a function of time. It is a very important physical quality which will allow us to build something. If you have 5 epochs, you do see acceleration, but this acceleration is not smoothly going in one direction. It is not that amplitude is continuously decreasing or amplitude is continuously increasing, you see something like a jerky thing, right? Of course, if you take into account errors, you can say that within 3 sigma, you can find something. But generally, you don't find some acceleration, but a decelerated acceleration or accelerated deceleration, you don't find these cases. So these are very important for modeling purposes. So last, one more puzzle from, okay, there are several puzzles I have put, I will continue with this. One more puzzle one finds is that there are broad absorption, this is formed by Pakhal. There are broad absorption lines with redshift greater than redshift of the quasar themselves. These are called as the inverse ball. So absorption line with redshift greater than redshift of the quasar is not a big deal, because you say quasar redshift is wrong, or you can see that gas is infalling, a clump is infalling. But producing an infalling clump with the velocity dispersion of 2000 km per second is a challenge for a model. Of course, several ideas have come up. You have binary quasar. So you have one guy which is a ball which is falling into the other quasar. So you see like this. Or you can say that, say this part is basically very difficult. Or there is a nice argument given, it's like rotation dominated outflows, basically outflows goes in rotation. And if you happen to be in a sideline where you see this guy going like this, you will see as if there is a deceleration or whatever velocity going up. So one of the things we try to do is to check this binary quasar by looking at the redshift. So you go and take infrared spectra of this object to see whether narrow lines, that you find two narrow lines, so that you can say there are two quasars which are present. This also allows you to measure the redshift to see that whether there is uncertainty, redshift, actual redshift will give emission here, and these are actual outflows. It seems that we can rule out these cases. We can rule out the case of this being binary. We can rule out this case of this being misidentified redshifts. Of course, rotation dominator one cannot check. But one more thing we can see is that these waves are highly stable. We observe them for over 10 years time scale. You don't find large variations in them. So again, going by this thing, this may not be the clump which is very close to the quasar itself. Because if they are very close to the quasar, with these velocities, they will be moving by delta r will be of the order of r. So it is not, you are not seeing it. So it's a puzzle which is sort of there in the case.
One of them. More than 15 minutes. Excuse me, can you explain why the narrow line region rules out the binary quasar?
Oh, so basically,
what length scale is the binary? What's the distance between the two black holes that you see?
So to produce, narrow line means what we are looking at is to look at two peaks. We make an assumption that both the quasars have central engine and a BLR and NLR.
And are unrelated or different redshifts.
Yes.
Okay, that's what you.
So one of them is falling like this. So this is like this, right? The guy which is falling has an outflow from whatever infall velocity with respect to the other quasar as the ball quasar. The ball is directed away from you. And it is, the velocity is like this, right? It's going like this. So for that to happen, both should have continuum light, both should have some emission light. So what we can show is that we don't find double peak emission in these cases.
Okay.
That's this.
And what is the fraction of these inverse balls compared to the...
So at present there are 30 candidates, and 10 of them are confirmed out of several thousand, right? So it's just a very small fraction, not a very... As I go in steps, the fractions goes down. The last bit of thing on ball quasar is that there is one more kind of quasars which we are beginning to observe now. These are these basically Petit Petitjean and Hassan. Name them as eclipsing DLAs or what they call ghostly DLAs. The interesting point is that you find a DLA at the redshift of the quasar. Okay? And you find strong laminar emission, but actually this carbon 4 emission and carbon 3 also broad emission lines, you don't see them in the Lyman alpha profile. So the understanding of this thing is that you have a DLA which means high column density neutral gas, which simply covers the broad line region and the central quasar, but it doesn't cover the narrow line region. So what is the advantage of these guys? This advantage is that this allow you to now actually probe this velocity field of Lyman alpha. Now you have the, in this 2000 km per second around the Lyman alpha line, you have no quasar now. Quasar has been removed. So now you can do IFUs or whatever, but what you are actually probing is the narrow line region and extended Lyman alpha regions, around this thing. So if you are interested in large scale flows, either in for or outflow, this candidates will allow you to do. So we started looking at this with putting slits in different position angles and taking the spectrum. IFE will be better. The requirement IFE will be to align slits in 2-3 position angles and try to look at the velocity fields in different directions. Of course, it becomes life is much easier compared to removing Poisson quantity. We don't have to remove Poisson quantity. There is no Poisson quantity. What you see is directly Lyapunov emission, and we can. This is the trace or test location of the quasar, and we can see this extension going up to something like 15 kiloparsec. Now we are beginning to see this Lyapunov clouds, which are so one will be able to couple this information with respect to the information you get from absorption line. So this study will provide important inputs into the surrounding region. So this is a very peculiar kind of. There are about 400 such candidates. This is no more a small number. 400 objects if you observe at a relative range of 2 to 3. Of course, more dramatic case of this is that imagine that there is a clump which covers only the Poisson continent, nothing else. Right? So this is the case here, and you see this is the absorption lines, and just for people who are used to Poisson absorption line, you know that silicate 2, zinc, sodium 1, oxygen 1, strong lines. If I show these lines and show strong C1, what will you conclude? This cloud has to be a DLA, right? Because only DLA will have sufficient ceiling very close to the quasar to produce this one. Not only that, it will be highly enriched DLAs. But here is the spectrum, you won't see the DLA at all. So there is a DLA present. You can calculate fine structure effect. More interesting thing is it shows fine structure length of silicate 2, carbon 2, etc. So what one understands now is that this is the spectrum. If DLA was present, blue color is what you have to see. But what you are seeing can be obtained by saying that there is a dense DLA, which is very close to the central engine, covers only the continuum region, and all other lines are leaking. In fact, one way of checking is to go and look at the Lyman beta line. Well, since Lyman beta emission is not that strong, we should see the Lyman beta absorption. In a couple of cases, we actually see Lyman beta, which is much stronger than Lyman beta. This is very interesting. It again, it's like you have a block which blocks things which allow you to probe the surrounding regions very well. So having said that, I will go rapidly into something which is now that we know cold gas can be very close to that, one of the best ways of probing cold gas is to do 21 centimeter absorption. And since we have JMRT close to Pune, and we are engaged in detecting 21 centimeter wherever possible, and I will just concentrate on 21 centimeter absorption for the central regions of quasars. Of course, basic idea to remember is that unlike any other absorption, 21 centimeter not only depends on the total number of hydrogen atoms present, it also depends on what thermal state they are. This is not a speed temperature. So you have to worry about what speed temperature you have and what column density you are measuring. So let me just go quickly into this. These 2 points are very important. What is the approach one takes? You can take all low redshift galaxies, look at quasars or radio emission in the central region, look for 21 centimeter absorption. This was done by people in Netherlands using ICO. I will present their results. The other thing one can do is look at all quasars which are available and look for 21 centimeter absorption. This was done by several people, including us, using JMRT and the BLA. I will give this thing. There is one caveat you have to remember. Caveat is that doing quasar spectroscopy in optical is very easy. Because as far as you are concerned, optical light is a point source. If you are taking spectra against the point source, it is much easier. When you are looking at something extended, like what we saw in the case of absorption line over emission lines where covering factor comes in, when you have a radio source which has all sorts of structures, you have to be very careful in deciding where the absorption line and where you are taking absorption again, which problem. Okay, this is the difficulty. In fact, if you are clever, you can convert that into advantage and say, like, I will go and look at radio sources at all scales and study absorption so that I can actually find the level size of these absorbers. So that's advantage as well as disadvantage. Detection is a problem. But once you detect, you can probe the structures very easily. So here is the result from this paper by Gerard et al. Okay, this shaded region I have forgotten, so if you have any question, I'll answer it wrong. Basically, what is plotted here is that this is the width of 21 centimeter absorption detected towards galaxies. This is the asymmetry. Where is the absorption line center with respect to the symmetric center of the absorption line? The first thing one notices is that the lines with large velocity widths, something like 400, few hundred kilometers per second, are highly asymmetric. This is the first thing you are learning. 21 centimeter absorption produces highly asymmetric lines when the width is also larger. Okay. So the same thing quantified in different ways, so I think this is good enough for us to go ahead. Second thing we can ask is that I know the redshift of the galaxy, I know the redshift at which this absorption line is going, I can calculate the relative velocity, how the relative velocity as a function of width itself. When one finds broad absorption lines, they seem to have large blue-shifted velocities with respect to systemic velocity. This is the first thing which is coming. If we think of this velocity as inflow and outflow, it seems that the largest outflow velocities one gets, right, are also broader ones. So whenever you find large outflow velocity, these tend to be broader. So the width is also of the order of whatever this is. Okay, now you can ask question, where do we take this centimeter absorption? Is there any preferential region where you detect them? What is plotted is the radio power. Are you detecting this in powerful radio sources or less powerful radio sources? For the range considered here, it seems that the detection rate is nearly uniform across the radio power. So that means the existence of cold gas does not depend too much on the power itself, in effectiveness. Okay. So this is within the redshifts. The redshift range is very small. You have to remember radio receivers are only now becoming better. You can't probe all cold range in redshifts. So what is found, what these people have found, is that within the redshift range probe, there is no redshift evolution, one is obviously seen. Only two things to note. It seems that when the radio sources are extended, you find the detection rates are small. This is what we expected from there. And the second thing is that they also divide this sample into two categories. One is that the red objects where there is more dust and slightly lower object where the dust is less, it seems that there is a tendency that dust poor galaxies produce less 31 centimeter absorption. So what is the take home message? So in low redshift galaxies, radio powers are very different, right? Because it's a galaxy selected sample, it's not a radio galaxy, radio selected sample, right? What one understands is that if you want to have large scale flows, 400, 500 kilometers per second, which are much more than these galaxies are nearby, you can calculate rotation speed of these galaxies, you can find out if this gas has to escape, right? So how much velocity it should have, this is the typical line here. So if you find any source above this, it's the most likely that they can escape the system. So what you see is that these kind of large things are seen only in powerful radio sources. If galaxies with powerful radio sources seems to be producing large outflows. Of course, if you say the large width, we also see the correlation between width and shift. So you see that picture here. The powerful, if you want to have a large shallow absorption line with large velocity width from the systemic redshift, you have to look at powerful radio sources. If you believe this seriously, it means that this flow, radio source has something to do with this flow which one's here. Of course, if you go back to this table, one thing which is very interesting, which comes up, is that when you look at interacting sources, it means like if you have a radio source in which two galaxies are interacting, what one finds is that nearly about 100%, say 80% of the cases you find absorption lines. So which prompted us to look at this in more detail. So we can look at, these are the samples, these are mini samples we have looked at with the GMRD. So these are something like 10 merging galaxies at redshifts much below 0.2. Mergers are based on standard things, right? You can, this is basically from the merger catalogs. The only cutoff we put is that object should be brighter than 40 milligrams B in the radio beam. And these are the absorption line which you detect. Of course, you cannot see them very well. The zero in each case is with respect to the center of the redshift of the galaxy. Whenever you find large absorption this side, you mean it's outflow. When you find absorption in the other side, you find it far. So what one finds when you have mergers, the first thing you find is that 80 to 90% of the mergers show 21 centimeter absorption. Which means that there is a huge amount of gas, cold gas, in the surrounding regions of the radio emission in these galaxies. If you look at the profile, whether they are infalling or outflowing, they are equally divided. There is no signatures of one direction. We cannot say that there is preferentially outflow or preferentially infall in these cases. Of course, what is more interesting is that having seen this, we took this other way around. We took all the sources for which 21 centimeter is detected without looking at what is the morphology of the radio, morphology of the galaxy. Now we go to each galaxy and ask what is the morphology, whether they are part of a merger or not. So now you can see fraction of mergers as a function of column density. What you can do is that consider all sources with column density more than 10 to the 19, 10 to the, as a function of column density cutoff. As you go to higher column density, what you find is that if you find higher column density absorbers, they tend to be part of mergers. It just proves this thing saying that there is huge amount of gas in the radio regions of the mergers. Now the question is chicken and egg. Whether the radio ejection is triggered by the fact that you accumulate a huge amount of gas there, or a huge amount of gas is there because radio is sort of doing something to it. Most likely the first part, right? Well, that's the thing one has to do for you. The same thing is plotted in histograms. You see that this is non-mergers and mergers, and you see that median is well shifted towards the higher points. Okay, so this is what is the summary. So wider absorption, about 300 kilometers per second, are always related to outflows. These absorption occur in very powerful radio sources. Also, these show high asymmetric cases. Mergers are very interesting. Okay, there is whole important features. In fact, for one case of this kind of things, we could do something special. Because this is the source, because you see this is systemic redshift, you find broad absorption. There are also two narrow absorption of infalling gas. This quasar, I didn't put the image of the quasar. It's actually two galaxies which are merging with each other. We went and observed this with VLBA. This is the image in the VLBA. This actually is the radio source now, split into two. So this scale, in physical scale, it corresponds to something like 90 parsecs. So what you can do now is that you can take spectrum towards this and this. This is what is shown here. This is spectrum towards south, and you see that almost nearly saturated 21 centimeter absorption. I have never seen it before. You can see the column density can be enormous. If you look at the northern source, you see that this absorption, there is a factor 20 change in optical depth within 90 kilopascals. 90 parsec, not 90 kilopascals, 90 parsec. It again tells you that even in the central regions, the gas is highly homogeneous, right? Because the dioxide, if you shoot just off by 80%, you will find that huge variations in. So this now we are following all our sources whenever they are above some threshold to look at VLBA. I know that two sources have been observed. In both cases, we see this. Whenever the central source splits into this, we find large variation. I think this will have an important clue on what kind of gas flows we are going to have on parsec scale close to this. In fact, most important point to mention here is that VLBA is sensitive to strong absorption. As it turned out that these absorption may be circum nuclear gas because they show both blue and red shift in this particular system. Okay. This is the last slide I wanted to show. The same thing you do as a function of redshift. So this is the detect, all these dark things are 21 centimeter detections, and these open things are 21 centimeter non-detections, and you see that this is the redshift range. And there is a clear indication, at least there is an indication, that there is increase in the detection of 21 centimeter absorption at the redshift of the quasar itself when you come towards the low redshifts. Of course, there is a big gap here because there is no receiver which is operating. There is also a big gap here because these receivers are not possible to operate because this is where we are using mobile phones. So now GMRT has come up with a wideband receiver, and there is a survey being conducted in both places. We are trying to chop out those places where this cell phone is there. In fact, this trend seems to be holding. Basically, we have more data here, and we find the detection is intermediate between what one sees here, and we will populate it with four bits now. But in the end, this is what we have said. Basically, detection rate is about 30-50% towards compact sources. Existing data suggests that increasing detection rate with decreasing redshifts. Absorption profile contains both narrow as well as broad, right? About 5% of the system flow clear signatures for outflow. Basically, very large flows are very rarely seen in produce. So this is consistent with what volunteered in the morning. Molecular flows are there, but they need not go at very large speeds. So only few cases one sees 2000 km per second large speeds. Of course, we ask this question. Our band itself is 3000 km per second. Are we missing something around 4000, 5000 km per second large scale winds? So now it is possible to check it because wide bands in GMRT allows you to search over large velocity scales. So gas kinematics, people say that basically you have three components, circumnuclear component. You also see jet flow interaction kind of signatures. You also see sort of outputs. So this thing is going to have a major boost now, thanks to what we are going to do called the BCAT absorption line survey. You know that BCAT is a radio telescope, which is which is going to be inaugurated on 15th of July in South Africa. So they are going, the first 3 years of operation, they are going to conduct eight large surveys. Midland absorption survey is one of those surveys where we are going to look at absorption line towards quasars, right, using this telescope. What is the big deal about this? This spectra will be taken exactly like optical data. There are about 15,000 channels covering 6 km per second width. So every time we'll have spectrum, we will look like quasar spectrum, right? Not small bands. So we will be targeting about 1,500 sources. This field is something like half a degree. In this field, any source which has more than 10 millijans EFLAX density L band, we will be having a spectrum in which we will be able to detect this associated absorption line. So these statistics, whatever I have presented, it will have a huge boost, because as far as intervening 21 centimeter absorption is concerned, we will be making factor 5 to 10 times more detections. As long as associated absorption, we are aiming to have 10 times more detections compared to what it did there before. If you want to see where it will be in terms of SDSS, it will be like data release 3 or 4. That is the kind of volume of data we will have. We will have full polarization, so you will be able to look at rotation measures of these objects, correlation between rotation measure and absorption lines. For select object, you will be able to do Zeeman splitting as well.
So what happened to that frequency
DLA?
Did you see
21
centimeters in there or not?
See, we are not so lucky. These are all radio
pioneers. Oh.
So we would like to see it. Most likely you will not see them because these are so compact. The radio has to be exactly aligned, otherwise you will not detect them. So that would have put constraint. CO would have been interesting, but we have not tried.
So these are transient systems you talked about earlier on with the emerging and disappearing lines. You mentioned one suggestion is that the UV continuum might be changing, and then that would change the ionization state of the line. Couldn't you just observe that?
That we don't see.
So no one has seen.
So basically what you are seeing is that you are seeing the optical. Optical, that's the only light we have. But if there is a relative change in optical to UV, that could trigger this. Because optical remains same, UV varies by huge amount.
Okay, so you don't have any chemistry, you have UV spectra from Hubble where you can see if they change.
So that would have been the thing to do. This is one thing I want to do with UV in AstroSat.
How do your H1 absorption results compare to the VLT spectroscopy samples? So with the VLT T project, people found that for radio galaxies smaller than about 50 kiloparsecs, you find strong absorption, whereas for larger radio galaxies, you didn't find the H1 absorption, the Lyman alpha absorption to the Lyman alpha line. So is that comparable to what you find, or do you find different scales?
So actually, this is slightly different scale because here what happens is that you are still looking at, okay, you are saying that absorption against the Lyman alpha emission, right?
Absorption against the Lyman alpha halo.
Yeah. So here we have the same thing. The size is less than few kiloparsec.
Few kiloparsec.
Yeah.
Okay.
What calls as compact deep spectrum sources, which are supposed to be double sources but embedded in the interstellar medium. Here the detection rate is pretty high.
Okay.
But this question, we will be answering this question because for one sample, we are doing both. We are looking at extended Lyman alpha emission as well as associated 21 centimeter absorption.
Okay. But then it seems to be something different.
We have not yet finished the survey. See, the Lyman alpha part we have done, this part is still going.
Okay.
So you mentioned about this redshift evolution. So you've seen that there are more number of absorber sources than nearby nodes. So can't there be a kind of observational bias?
Yeah, I think that is one problem. That's what I said. When we do our survey, we would have looked at all sources above some limit, irrespective of the redshift. So then you will get all these. The other thing is also there, whether radio emission from optical selected quasars or dust-ridden quasar, they may be different. The associated absorption, some claim historically in the past that red quasars have more associated absorption, but it's not clear.
Less.
Going back to the body paper, So what is your comment on the connection between bar absorption, broad absorption, and complete and transfer process?
They may be related, but they cannot come from the same phase, I would think, because you see the velocities here.
No, but you mentioned that there would have to be a spread of material along the
line of sight,
right?
Yeah, I have not looked at it very carefully, because I would have some answer had I actually analyzed. What one has to do is to systematically analyze the radiation going through this, and you should have a simultaneous UV observation, right?
Right. So we recently did, we saw it both in X-rays and UV. So the reason I'm asking is that how often can this happen? Because in nature, if the synergy is known, then you can plan for observations. And planning in this case is very important because the ultra-fast outflows are really variable. They just vanish. And to find them together, one needs to know and plan very properly.
I don't have prediction power. But I think there are two cases if you can do it low redshift and where you have simultaneous observations of all.
No, but balls are not seen as X-ray outflow.
That ball is a problem.
In PG-12-11, we recently found both. So, and it was published just a few months ago. So, hence I'm asking that in the literature, what is the
I think you know.
See, yeah. If you have found it, that would be the first.
Okay. You have to build a sample. As statistics.
Okay, we finish. Thanks, Mr. Turner.